Hello. Welcome back to Rhythm and Word as we celebrate God's gift of Sabbath rest. I'm Amy Pagliarella, one of the pastors here at Fourth Presbyterian Church. And last week we introduced Sabbath as our theme for July, remembering that God blessed the Sabbath and consecrated it or made it holy. Now, I love this idea that the Sabbath is blessed and set aside for a sacred purpose. But there have always been folks who need a little more definition. They want to know, what does this actually mean? How do we keep the Sabbath? What really makes it holy? And how do we know if we're doing it right? In Jesus' time, there were religious leaders who painstakingly interpreted the Hebrew Bible, trying to explain to people what was permissible on the Sabbath. What was the maximum length of a Sabbath day's journey? Was it okay to light a fire? Could you feed and water your livestock? There were people then and people now who find deep meaning in following these rules. They find it brings them closer to God, and that's beautiful. But for others, these kind of rules can create a barrier. I once mentioned the idea of Sabbath to a woman at a church gathering and was immediately met with a deep scowl. It turns out that she grew up in this very Christian corner of Western Michigan, where Sundays were a day of lengthy church services in which little kids were expected to be on their best behavior. After morning worship, families would gather together for supper before returning to a second worship service that evening. Now, for the children, this was cruel and unusual punishment. They were allowed to be together. They could go outside, but they were prohibited from playing on what was supposed to be a serious, godly day. So she told me that the kids invented a game called sidewalk tag. They chased each other by walking as quickly as they could, but not breaking into a run. That would be too much like play. And they had to stay on the sidewalk because it was only a game if they stepped on the grass. It sounded like the letter of the law had become more important than the spirit. And this reminds me of a story from the Gospels. Mark tells us that Jesus and his disciples were walking through a field of wheat on the Sabbath day when they paused to pluck some grain. The religious leaders see this and they seize the opportunity to catch Jesus breaking the rules again. Jesus hears their criticism and responds, "The Sabbath was created for humans. Humans weren't created for the Sabbath." You see, Jesus turns this around. He says the Sabbath was made for us. We weren't created so that God would have someone to follow all these Sabbath rules. The Sabbath was created so that we would experience its gifts of rest, restoration, and joy. And so if you're hungry on the Sabbath, eat. If you're a kid, run. And if you gather with others, enjoy. Which is all terrific. But then we have to wonder, does the Sabbath look just like any other day? Well, no, because God still tells us that one day out of every seven is special, holy. And Rabbi Abraham Heschel says that Sabbath is not a date, but an atmosphere. Sabbath is made holy by our intention and attitude, not the day of the week or our activities of choice. And so Pastor Marianne McKibben Dana wrote a book about this. Her family took on a year-long experiment with Sabbath. Sabbath in the Suburbs describes her desire to create new rhythms of family time so they could relax and delight in one another and in God. They set aside Saturdays, and each week they pursue Sabbath activities. They go to a farmer's market, take a bike ride, or listen to music. They decide a little TV is okay, but social media is not. Some kinds of work are permitted. She knits, her husband bakes bread, the kids play the piano. But they don't pursue activities that change their environment. No checking items off the to-do list or tackling home improvement, because this is important. These kinds of tasks imply that their family is just not good enough, or their house is just not good enough the way they are or it is. And so they have enough rules to set boundaries, but they keep these rules fluid and flexible. Occasionally, the family only has an afternoon for Sabbath, or she or her husband need to step away for a work activity. But the default is always to set aside time and to keep that time holy. Dana writes, "Our calendars are spiritual documents. To-do lists and Google calendars are statements of faith. Our family's statement of faith said, we are busy with good and important things, but have no time to stop and enjoy God's creation. We believe in our own self-importance. We would never have said such things aloud," she writes, "but our lives betrayed us." Now, you might notice none of her Sabbath activities are particularly churchy, and they aren't about following rules, no sidewalk tag or kids on their best behavior, just a family delighting in each other and in God. If Rabbi Heschel is right, and Sabbath is not a date but an atmosphere, what kind of atmosphere would you like to set for your Sabbath time? Perhaps life is just nuts these days, in which case, take this brief time with Rhythm and Word as your Sabbath. But if you'd like more time to delight in God, take it. There's always going to be something on your calendar or your to-do list that tries to trick you, make you think you don't have the time. So it's my hope and prayer for you this week that you will set aside a window of time and create a Sabbath atmosphere. Choose to do something life-giving. It could be as simple as a nap or a walk. And act like that Sabbath time was made just for you, because it was. So take that time and simply be. Be you, be with God, and enjoy.
Instead of me, always seems to know.